Hey, everybody.
Hey, everybody.
Welcome to Janine and Amy's Travel TV Live. And I feel like I haven't been here in weeks. Well, Amy and I were at an awesome virtual conference, although it would have been more awesome live, but it was still a good conference last week.
Yeah, absolutely. It was a great meeting. It really, really was. We had a good time. I'm starting a watch party so that we can get some people on. Come say hi.
Hi. So all today we are talking, as you can see, is just the two of us, which is entertaining in and of itself. But we thought a good topic would be to talk about global entry, TSA pre-screen, clear, real ID, all that. It's not fun, but it's important. And yes, we know that no one's traveling right now, but that means it's a perfect time to apply for all these services. Renew your passport would be a great idea to do that now too. So while we're all hanging around, why not consider, you know, getting global entry? So I have global entry and you do too, Amy.
Yep.
I don't know about you, but for me, it has literally meant the difference between making my plane and missing my plane on more than one occasion. Even when I get to the airport in the 2 hours for domestic and 3 hours for international, really, it's made a huge difference. So I don't know what made you decide to get it? Was it just being jealous of everybody passing by you in TSA pre-check?
Yes, that's exactly what it was, actually. That's exactly what it was. And, before all this mess in 2020, Tim and I, just like you and your husband, travel a lot. And you spend hours and hours and hours trying to get through customs. And I remember watching all these people walking by me saying, you know, and I'm looking at Tim, I'm like, why are we not those people? I don't get it. So he started doing all this research into it. I'm like, how hard can this possibly be? And then the first time, I don't know about you, the first time I used Global Entry to enter back into the United States, mm-hmm, I scanned my passport and I stood there waiting for somebody to say
what to do.
And the TSA lady's looking at me at Homeland Security, and she said, no, you're done. You're good. Like, that's it. And meanwhile, I'm looking behind me at all the lines, everything like that. I'm like, I'll see ya.
Yeah. So it's possible to apply for TSA PreCheck and Global Entry separate. Although if you apply to Global Entry, you get both. So I don't know why you wouldn't do both. It's a little bit more expensive, but TSA pre-screen, although it used to be like in the know type of thing, crowded now, but still, you can still blow right through most of the time and it makes a big difference. So I did a little research yesterday just to confirm. So Global Entry is cost $100 still, and it lasts for 5 years. And you still need to make an appointment to get an interview. And unfortunately, because of COVID-19, things have been, pushed back a little bit. But still, if you don't have anything big planned, it's worth it. And I think if you travel more than 2 to 3 times a year, it's worth every penny.
It's totally worth it. And if you have a Capital One Venture card, they will reimburse you the $100.
I did not know that.
Yeah, that's what I did. So if you use your venture card to pay for your global entry fee, which is all done online, Janine, and I'll explain to you how this is done. It's so incredibly easy. It's crazy. Mm-hmm. But if you use your venture card, you get a refund on your statement. And that's cool. Right? Yeah.
Maybe they want you to travel and spend a lot of money on your credit card. So they're like,
they want you to use your venture card.
But it is pretty easy. My kids have it too. And we really just, this is before COVID though. We just had to go into Boston. You have to go to an airport where there's a global entry service department. And then just wait your turn, really, more than anything else. But have you heard about clear? Now that's something I have not done yet. And I feel weird about it. So it's a biometrics screening service that's now in 40 airports. So you, and it's cheap. It's $15 a month. So again, if you travel a lot and you don't mind them having your biometrics data.
Yeah.
Because you apply online. And then when you get to the airport, you provide a scan of your iris and your fingerprints. So it's definitely sci-fi stuff.
And holy cow. Is it all done through like Homeland Security and the Department of State, like Global Entry? Is it really?
Well, it's a it seems to be a private company. And of course they must be working with, you know, the State Department and TSA and all that. But so it's interesting to me. And I'm curious if anybody out there has used it and what you thought of it. Because what I read too is that they're planning to use it at like stadiums. So to improve security and you go through, right. But you wonder, I mean, again, I signed up for Global Entry, so they have a lot of my data.
Yeah, they have everything.
Right? Yep. I guess it's the difference. Yep. You always think about those sci-fi movies where it's, the robots take over.
Right. Well, I think biometrics, especially now under the COVID world we live in, I really believe that's probably going to be the future going forward, because people are still going to want to move freely around the world, and us keeping us locked down won't stay for very long. People want to get back out there. And I think that part of the solution to traveling and getting from point A to point B, especially internationally, is probably going to be biometrics, I would think, especially anybody who gets a vaccine or anybody who's immune or whatever the case may be. It'll be easy, 1, 2, 3, and you can come through. So I know some of the airlines are doing it already where you can get tested, and they're trying to create virus-free flights, essentially. So everybody gets tested before you get on a rapid test, and then everybody on the flight is negative, which I think is kind of cool.
Well, I'm sure you have gone to airports, and I know I have, that you walk through a heat detector.
Yes.
For fevers. So when we were to go to Taiwan, you walk through, and I don't know, they must pull you aside. So I have a feeling that's going to be more common now. And just probably we'll see it at every airport.
Yeah, I think so.
But it's interesting, and I think that, like, you're right, the COVID testing, they're starting to do it at some airports that you can get the
test. Yeah. Yeah.
So that, and also some destinations are requiring it when you arrive, even if you have a test.
Yes.
2 hours ago. So it's funny because, of course, if you were to be infected on a plane, you wouldn't know when you landed.
No,
but a lot of them are there, but a lot of places like Bermuda things are requiring like 5 days after you arrive and that type of thing. So it's a whole new world. It's a whole new world.
It is indeed. It is indeed. We're all just kind of trying to run and catch up to, so we can get back out there again. So I agree. I absolutely agree. So let's walk everybody through what it's like and the steps that you have to go through. I think everybody thinks it's really complicated, and it's the simplest thing in the world, provided that you're an upstanding citizen.
And you have $100.
Absolutely.
Well, it's true. So the nice thing about TSA Pre-Check is when you buy your plane ticket, you just put in your known passenger number, and it's automatically put onto your boarding pass.
And you walk right through.
You just zip right through. And the nice thing, another nice thing, is that means if you have never done it before, you can keep your shoes on, you can keep your belt on.
Yeah.
You can keep your computer in your bag.
Yeah.
So there's a lot of nice things.
Yeah, absolutely. And the only thing I think you even have to worry about is taking a coat off. I think that's the only thing I've ever had to worry about was taking a coat off.
Yeah.
And, traveling in the wintertime or even on a rainy day like today. So I believe
I get pulled over a lot in security.
That's because you're shifty looking.
It has to be. Like, my family laughs, not much in the United States because we have TSA Pre-Check, but when we're traveling overseas, I get pulled over all the time. Right? And I'm like, really? Whatever. It's hilarious though.
You're pretty scary. You're pretty scary looking. So yeah, Tim does too. It's like almost every trip he gets pulled aside to do something. And I stand there, I'm just like, okay, here we go. And I just wait.
I know. Well, yeah. that's another tip from me. Don't complain.
If you never.
Just smile and say thank you, because really, is it better to be right or miss your flight? I didn't mean to rhyme, but
hey, that's probably a good model.
Yeah. Better to be right or miss your flight.
Right.
So when we were in Iceland, Iceland has two security points. If you haven't been there, then every American got pulled out after the second security, every American. So this was last summer, 2019, and there was a gigantic line of us. And of course, we'd all been there for a long time. We'd gone through one security and everyone had just kind of, I don't know, you hang around. And we were screened, and then we got a second screening before we could go to our flight. Every American.
I wonder why. I don't know
if that was a political statement by the Icelandic government, but it was interesting. Yeah.
Holy cow, seriously.
Flights, I mean, it was a mess. People were screaming and it was crazy.
Wow.
But I was calm and I'm like, worst comes to worst, we stay one more night in Reykjavik, right? I mean, I guess.
Right. Yeah. One of my girlfriends was there and she said the same thing, that all a bunch of Americans got pulled out. I wonder why that was. And she said, now I don't know how true this is, but they asked her when they pulled her aside who she voted for.
What?
That's what she said. I don't know if that's accurate or not, but that's what she said. And I was like, really? And what difference is that going to make? But
they didn't ask me that. They didn't ask me that. So
yeah, I can't imagine that's a thing. I just can't. No.
But global entry is for when you come back in the United States, and the U.S. and Customs and Border Control mobile app is something new as well for when you come back into the United States. And you know, you get that piece of paper on the plane, and the whole family the family has to fill it out. And that's what you give to the customs person, the border control person. But if you use the app or you have global entry, you don't have to fill one of those out. And even with the app, they give you an encrypted code that you don't have to stop at the kiosk. So if people watching don't have it, you get a card for global entry, but you don't need it. You just get off the plane, you go up to the kiosk, you put your thumbprint, you scan your passport, and then you go into a special lane. And you do have to talk to a border control person, but it's like 10 seconds. And you
go literally 10, not even that.
So with this app, you get to skip the kiosk and go through that same line. So I haven't used it, and I found it when I was researching this. So I am going to check it out. It sounds like a cool.
Holy cow. Can you give us the link when we put the show up? Yeah. And because as you know, I'm bringing my daughter to Mexico in a few weeks. So trying to step out and see what it's like to travel in this world that we live in right now. So I would love to have
you go live. Maybe we can get you to go live.
I will. I'll do it. I can do it. Yeah, that's no problem. I'm actually excited about it. It's going to be an interesting adventure. So we'll see what it's like. So I'll be sharing what it's like to be at the airport and what it's like, because we have to get tested. Molly, my daughter, has to go back to work. We're leaving from Bradley in Connecticut. So she has to get tested because we live in Massachusetts. So anybody who's watching, we live in Massachusetts. So we either have to be tested or quarantine for 14 days. Well, Molly has to go back to work, and I certainly don't want to get stuck in my house again for 14 days straight. So she and I have to make arrangements, and we can get tested at Bradley. And we have a layover in Miami, and we can get tested there as well. So, and we have like 3-hour layover. So I'm thinking maybe we just get tested in Miami and have our results by the time we land, or at least the next day, and then Molly can go to work and I can carry on with my life. So I'll let you know. Absolutely. You want me to go? I'll do it. I'll go live.
And that would be good. That'd be fun. I'd like to see what the airports are like now. And I'm going to bet that they're more crowded than we think they're going to be. I have a feeling once you get to Miami, it's going to be like a regular, I don't know about Hartford, but Brad, I think Miami will be busy. So yeah, that'd be great. But so back to the show.
Yeah, sorry. Yeah, I digress.
So, and I also wanted to bring up, so I will include all the links in the show notes for this, so you can find out how to apply for Global Entry, TSA Pre-Check, find out more about the app. I'll also include a link to about renewing your passport, because passport is backed up like 18 months or something.
Yeah,
like,
it's ridiculous.
So if you, maybe it's not that long. I think I exaggerated.
It's months though, yeah, for sure.
I make it more dramatic by saying 18 months. But so that's our recommendation, is why not do it now?
Yeah.
Just go and do it now.
And the other thing too, Janine, a lot of people don't know. So you can't travel if your passport expires within 6 months of you arriving home. So many people don't know this. It's not like public knowledge. Mm-hmm. So again, a good reason to use travel advisors, because we help you with these things.
We know that type of stuff.
We know that thing. So so if you plan to travel, so as an example, anywhere in the world, and you plan to travel, let's say this coming January, but your passport expires in May, you cannot travel. You have to have a new passport. So your passport can't expire. So if your passport's expiring, I would say in the year, anytime in 2021, your passport's going to expire, I would apply now, because they are wicked backed up.
Right. Yes. Especially if you're planning to do something in 2021. Why be stressed about it?
Right. Exactly. Or even thinking about doing something, you should have a new passport. Absolutely.
Yeah, definitely. So, and that brings me to Real ID. So probably most people know this. I already have my Real ID, but it has been extended to October 2021 because a lot of the RMVs have shut down. But I did not know this. So if your license expired after March 1st, 2020, you can fly with an expired license for a year. I know. So I couldn't believe it. I looked it up yesterday. So
I'll
put the link so everybody confirm that. Just in case. But no, I did go to, I did look up the Real ID to check the facts. And they're doing that because so many of the RMVs have been closed because of COVID. And so even, we're just trying to do the normal day-to-day registry of motor vehicle stuff, and there's only two open around us now, and they're not.
Yeah.
So that's just something FYI, but you do want to start thinking about getting your Real ID, and we'll put the link for that as well, because the thing is, you need more identification. That's, you need something with your address on it. You need a passport. You need a whole bunch of stuff to get the Real ID. It's a little bit more involved. So we'll put the link in for that too. And maybe it's time to start thinking about that as well.
Well,
and you're not going anywhere, because I tell you what, I mean, I check to make sure I have the right passport 1,000 times before I leave the house. Oh. Like getting somewhere and not being able to fly because of that reason, forget it. I mean, it's not worth it. It's so much stress. Just take care of it while we're all hanging around.
Yeah. Yeah. I had a honeymoon couple last year. It's the saddest story ever. Honeymoon couple. And they were taking notes. And she wrote it in her passport.
What?
She wrote a bunch of notes about something on her passport. Guess what that does, folks?
Yeah.
It invalidates your passport. You cannot travel. They were trying to get out.
Oh, geez.
Yeah, they were checking in at the airport, and they said, yeah, no, you can't go.
Oh, my God.
So she calls me, and I'm like, what happened? And she's telling me. I wrote a whole blog on it about the do's and the don'ts with your passport, and basically sign it. That's it. Don't take pages out. Don't do anything. So yeah.
You can have pages added.
Yes.
It has to be done officially. Like my husband has pages added because he used to travel so much for business that he had to have some added to his passport, but that's it. Don't mess with it.
Yeah. No, just sign it and where it says signature
and be done.
Yeah, it was really awful. Yeah, so we had to get her a new passport, which took days and blah, blah, blah. But anyway.
So I thought we could run through. So these aren't tips like getting global entry, but just a couple tips from our years on the road about ways to get through security faster. So after you've gotten global entry and done all that stuff, or maybe if you don't, right?
Yeah.
A couple of things that I do, and Amy can chime in as well. So I always suggest checking the status of your flight before you leave home, because that doesn't have a lot to do with security, but it does affect the amount of time you are stuck in that airport.
Oh, no kidding.
So we were traveling to the Azores once, and we got a text in Portuguese. We're like, okay, what does this mean? So we looked up Google Translate, and it said our flight was delayed 12 hours. So, and then the people who were traveling with us, some of them were already on the road to the airport, and then other people ignored the text. I don't know why.
Oh my Lord. No.
So instead of leaving at 3 in the afternoon, we left at 3 in the morning. So that's a long day in the airport. So check and sign up for the airline's app.
Always.
They'll text you and let you know.
Oh, absolutely. Yeah, absolutely. Yep.
I also suggest weighing your luggage. This is a random thing, but I don't know if this has that ever happened to you, Amy, where your luggage weighs too much?
Of course not, Janine. Uh-huh. Never. That's never happened to me.
So years ago, so we can laugh about this stuff. Now, this is before I was a travel advisor, so that's why it's funny. I was traveling with my two kids, and they were young. They were probably 7 and 9. And my husband had, we were in England, and he went on to for business on the continent, and I flew home. And I only wanted one bag because I had to deal with the two kids. And I'm like, it's too much. Well, the bag was so heavy, I couldn't even lift it. And they ended up charging me 100 pounds. They're like, the woman said to me, go buy a bag. And I'm like, where am I going to buy a bag? I'm like, so that's this happened to me story.
Yeah.
To weigh it in the airport. And plus, we've all seen the people with their luggage and stuff all over the place. And
all the time.
That's funny.
All the time. And when people do that, don't get annoyed. They just don't travel a lot. But learn from that lesson. I remember a couple years ago, I was taking my kids to, they were traveling down to New Orleans to go see their birth father. And there was a family in front of us, and they had put things in plastic bags, and they were trying to check it. And they're not going to take plastic bags. And it was all clothes. So you know what they did? They put all the clothes on. I'm not kidding. They put hat over hat over hat over hat, jackets and sweaters, and they were all just taking clothes out and dressing them because they for whatever reason, they
like trash bags,
just like shopping bags. So think like a Macy's bag or TJ Maxx, whatever. And they had purchased all this stuff, and I can't remember even where they were headed, but they were the counter people are like, no, yeah. You can't check a Macy's bag.
I read an article about going economy basic. And I don't know if people out there know what economy basic is. It is the cheapest flight, cheapest seat on the plane, but you can't check a bag, you can't bring a carry-on, you can't, you're the last person on the plane, you can't select your seat. It's not for me.
Nor I.
But the person who wrote the article about it, that's what he did. He put all his clothes on and wore all his clothes on the plane. He showed them.
Stick it to the airline.
That's right. So a couple other ideas in the last few minutes. And Amy, to give us your ideas too. I'm always for, if you're not going through TSA PreCheck, get in line behind a business person. Avoid families.
They're professionals.
Yes. My husband is the most efficient security screening person there is.
Yep.
Do that. And also be ready yourself. Have your important documents, your computer, everything in the front pocket so you can pull it out quickly and get it out and get it back in and then be out of there.
Be on your way. Absolutely. Yep. Absolutely.
And have your documents.
That person. Say again?
And have your documents handy.
Like, always.
I know it's not very far from where you get your boarding pass if you haven't printed it at home, but people seem to lose it.
I know.
And it's all, all over the place.
Yeah, and use your phone, just download it, because then you can scan it when you're going through. It's like that. It's wicked, wicked fast.
Yeah, it's wicked fast. And I just have one more for families, and especially if you don't fly a lot and you have younger kids, talk to them about what to say to the TSA personnel.
Yes.
Like and we all know, so what they'll ask is, who are you traveling with? Like your relationship, that type of thing. They want to make sure you're not being kidnapped. The kids are being kidnapped.
That's true. But yeah. Kids
sometimes, and parents think it's clever. They don't think it's funny. But let me tell you, so we went to Florida. Oh my gosh, it feels like it was 10 years ago now because we haven't traveled so long, but it's just last year.
Yeah.
With my son and his friend. So we go up to security, and because he has a different last name than us. And the TSA guy said, so who are these people? You know, do you know them? And he's like, oh yeah, it's my buddy's parents. You know, they're my friends. And he looked at him and said, well, I suppose that's what someone who was being kidnapped would say too. We're like, don't say that, right? I know, can you imagine? I mean, the only thing is that they're both like almost 6 feet tall. So it's not like, I mean, like I could kidnap them even if I wanted to.
Right, right.
I'm just like, oh my God, you cheek.
Shut up already. Yeah. Yeah. No, you don't mess around with them. You have to answer them and thank them. Be polite. Call them sir and ma'am. These people take it on the chin every single day, and all their only job is to keep us safe.
Right.
And I remind people that when they get antsy in line, and I look at them like, you know what? It might not be you that's a bad guy, but somebody behind you is a bad guy. So let's make sure they stop them too.
Yeah.
And you just have to remember that's their job. And I, you know, just get to the airport early. Don't stress out about it. That's my biggest, I tell all my clients, everybody who will listen, don't be one of those people that thinks you can do it in 20 minutes, because that's the minute you're going to, and then you get all stressed out. That's when people get angry because they didn't plan properly. And if it's an early flight and you have a drive, so if you have a wicked, wicked early flight, say 5, 6, 7 a.m., and you're flying. So for Janine and I, Boston's a good hour and a half to 2 hours away. And if you're flying internationally and you have a 7 a.m. flight, you have to be there at 4 o'clock in the morning, which means that we have to leave our house at 3 o'clock in the morning, 2:30 in the morning. So just stay, go in the night before. That's what Tim and I do. We stay at the Hyatt that's attached, or the Hilton that's attached to Logan. Yep. And there's a Sheraton attached to Bradley. And you go in, that way you have a nice lazy dinner. You start your vacation a little early. Life is good. You're right there at the airport.
You need vacation dance. Woo!
Too wild and crazy girls. So anyway, so that would be my recommendation, is just, you know, be there early. It's better to be early than like all stressed out. Way to start your vacation.
I know.
Completely wigged out and stressed.
Yeah. We've all seen it. We've all seen the people in the line and say, I have to, my flight. Well, everybody has a flight, right? I mean, you're not the only person with the flight. And I know sometimes it's traffic, whatever, but you have to plan and just give it. And you know what? Airports are boring. Yes. But I'd rather be there for an extra hour than
absolutely
screaming through the, you know, concourse, freaking out that I'm not going to make the flight.
So. Absolutely. I agree with you. I absolutely agree with you. So those are the best words of advice. And get TSA pre-check, actually get Global Entry. Even if you travel internationally 2 times a year, mm-hmm. It's worth it. Totally yes. Worth it. And use your Capital One Venture card to get the money.
For an extra added bonus.
Right. And to be clear, I don't get anything for that. It just happened to be my experience. That's all I'm saying.
That credit card. It's my favorite.
Yeah.
Well, so we hope this is helpful to everyone. And again, we'll put all the links in the show notes and in the post. And thank you for coming. And if you have any questions for us, really just post them below. We're happy to answer them as always.
Always.
If you have any ideas for topics, if you have questions for something that you'd like us to talk about, or we're happy to do that. So just let us know. And until next time, keep dreaming about travel and finding joy close to home. And we'll see you next week. And guess what? We're going to England.
Yeah, we are. I am so excited.
So, and we'll be on at 6 o'clock. So new time, same channel. And we'll see you next week, everybody. Bye.
Bye. Thanks.